The following is a presentation of Knotche Creek Baptist Church in Madisonville, Tennessee. For more information, please visit knotchecreekbaptist.org.
In Jesus' name this morning, thank you for the opportunity you've given us to come to your house. Father, you know every heart among us today. You know mine. God, the Bible says you know my thoughts even afar off. You know my future, and I thank you for my hope that I have in you. I pray your blessings be upon our time this morning. Bless this offering. Bless your people. Help us that we would come just with one thing in mind, and that would be to worship you this morning. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Can I have your attention? How many loves your wife?
Amen.
Okay. All right. She's looking. How many loves your wife? All right. You volunteered to sing to them this morning. Come on. Come on. Come on, guys. Come on, everybody. I don't care if you visit her, who you are. Come on. Come on. You got to sing. It's not going to be hard. Hey, Josh, get them ready. Dan? Some of you guys, come on. You must not love his wife. You love your wife? Well, okay. Now, one last question I have. Okay. Taking care of some stuff. Okay, now, I ask you a question. Do you love your wives enough to come and sing to her? And some of you, I understand why you don't sing. Okay, what about you you guys? How many of you guys sitting out there got a girlfriend? Huh? All right, come on. You can sing. You can come on. I'm just going to get every one of you. Come on, guys. It's not a big deal, fellas. These folks up here cover up for you. All right. Thank you for letting me have a little fun with you this morning. I hope I didn't embarrass anybody. But we're going to sing. Josh, go ahead, brother.
Sing from somewhere to my
the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter number 17. Very familiar passage. I want to talk to you this morning for a few minutes from these verses. I'll be reading from 8 through 16. 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 8 through 16. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, speaking to Elijah, said, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So she arose. So he arose, and he went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gates of the city, behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks. And he called her and said, fetch me, I pray thee, a little vessel of water that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called unto her and said, hey, while you're at it, why don't you bring me a morsel of bread in thy hand? The Bible says in verse 12, and she said, as the Lord thy God liveth, I have not a cake. All I've got is just a handful of meal in a barrel. Got a little oil in a cruse. And behold, I am gathering two sticks that I may go and dress it for me and my son, and we may eat, and it's going to be our last meal. We're going to die. And Elijah said unto her, fear not, go and do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it to me, and after make for thee and for thy son. For thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither the cruse of oil fail, until the day that the Lord has sent rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil fail, according to the words of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Father, bless your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. A drought was in the land. 2.5 years. And the land had dried and the resources had withered away. And we find Elijah. We find a little widow. And we find the son. And the Bible says that God instructed Elijah where to go get a meal. The Word of God tells us that he sent him to a little widow, a little woman that had very little resources. Her husband had died, and there she was, struggling to get by. Then God would send someone to her house that she might provide for someone else. And I, maybe in my thoughts, as I read this and I thought about what God was doing here, maybe she thought, well, do I not have enough to do already? The Bible says that God had a request of her. I thought about how that we struggle in America today across our world and how it is with single moms. How they struggle with resources and, and a lot of we got a lot of cushions that we could help, the government helps and things of that nature. But listen, God established the home. God, the Bible says in Genesis chapter number 2, verse 24, and it says these words, and a man shall leave his father and his mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall be one flesh. God ordained the home. That's just the way it is. Now, I know that we're living in a day today that our home life in America has decided to play God in avenues that they need to keep their hands off of. Listen, folks, God established the home. It don't make no difference what our government says a home is. God established a man and a woman to be the ones that raises children and brings them into the world. And I thought about how many times we as parents, we have forgotten when God gives you a baby, that is a gift to you that is of God. It's His. It's not yours. Daddy, you had a part in it. Mama, you had a part in it. But God allowed that to happen. And folks, it's for His glory and His honor. And when you have a newborn son or baby, it's not of your making. God had to allow that to happen. I know moms that have tried and parents, they've tried to have children in Canaan. And all at once, God just intervened. Sometimes not. But I had a friend of mine, he and his wife, they couldn't have children. They adopted twins. And within months, she'd got pregnant. Guess what? Had twins there, wound up four kids in a year. Man, and that's about all they wanted, he told me. God has marvelously blessed. And I thought about how that we have taken it and confused. We're living in a confused generation. You remember when God sent Noah down to Nineveh? The Bible says that there was 120,000 that could not discern their right hand from their left hand. And why did He send the man of God? Because the man of God was the priest of the Word of God. So I find how the condition that America is, Romans chapter 1, you read verse number 26, and you'll see where we are in America. Oh, we are an educated nation. We are a rich nation. We're an industrial nation. And folks, everybody seems like they've got it together. But I want you to understand how confused we are today and why we're confused. And the Bible says, and God gave them up to what? To what? Vile what? Affections. Are we not living in a generation of vile affections? Are we not living with a group of folks in America that has vile affections? Listen, folks, we've come to the point anymore that we don't even know which bathroom to use. Amen? I tell you, mamas and daddies, some of you ought to point out what they are. They ought to tell them what they are. Listen, folks, we're living. And I tell you this, folks. You talk about a warped generation. Don't be complaining about rape when you send the little boys into the girls' bathroom. Don't be complaining about vice versa. And we're living in that the time that everybody's free. Everybody can do this, ladies. Listen, folks, I guess maybe I'm going to have a rant and rage this morning, but bless God, I'm going to have it anyway. I'm telling you, folks, we're living in a generation that God has ordained a home, and we've warped a home. We've come to a place in America we don't even know what's right and wrong. Why? Because of their vile affections. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, when you have vile affection, then all sin becomes okay. And listen, when Satan comes, he takes what's right wrong, and he takes what's wrong and makes it right in the sight of man. But I want you to know God is still final authority. And I believe the Word of God. And the Bible tells us here that, folks, we see a little old lady,
And what if she was living in the day we live in today? It would be a different day. But folks, I see three little things that I think should come back to America's homes. Number one is, the Bible says 8, 9, and 10, we find this little lady, folks, she had a relationship with her God. Hey, folks, I believe that American moms across our world today, I believe they should come back to a relationship with God. Folks, why that we living in a state we're living in, I believe this, folks, that men and women have lost a relationship with God. And when you lose a relationship with God, you know what? You've lost all moral fiber. You've lost everything that controls your lifestyle. I believe that men and women, and today is Mother's Day, but I see this little lady, she had a relationship with God. What did the Bible say? God said, I picked me out a little woman, and I want to send you by her house, and she's going to supply your needs. Listen, folks, I thought about what Jesus said in Luke chapter 4. You know what he said? Jesus even brought up the account of this little woman. What did he say about her? Why, he said in Elijah's day, he said there was all kinds of widows out there, but he chose one to be able to supply the need. And then he moves on down to the next verses, and he talks about Elisha. This was the one that followed after Elijah. And the Bible says that he said, was there more than just one leper in the land, but he chose Naaman. Why did he do that? I believe, folks, it's because of relationships. And we forget sometimes that God wants to have a relationship. Hey, moms, the greatest thing that ever happened to you is that you would have a relationship with your Maker. Sometimes we forget how to do that, but it's through the Lord Jesus Christ. It's only through Him. And I was thinking about this little lady. Folks, she was acquainted with sorrow. She was a woman that had depleted of all the things that sustained her life. Listen, she didn't have anything to offer. She was a little woman that was going to die. Just make a cake, a little oil, put a little oil in it, make a cake and die. She had no hope for the future. She had no hope for her family. Everything had dried up. The land had dried up. The resources were gone. And she had nobody to depend on. But guess what? God sent a man. The Bible says that he picked her out. She was at the gate. She was a lady of sorrow. I don't know this, but I believe the Spirit of God said, there she is. And he showed her to the man of God. The Bible tells us that she was in trouble. You know what? In her last days, could have been her last 2 days or three, she was still busy about providing for her family. You see, if you want to have something done, don't ask the lazy person. Lazy people's not going to do no more than what they have to do. But this little woman, she was just scratching up all she could to be able to provide for her family. Why? Because I believe, folks, that she had a relationship with God because God had picked her out. What did God do? There was probably thousands of virgins, but he picked out Mary. Folks, the Bible tells us that Jesus could have talked about a lot of people, but he talked about a little woman that had two mites that she cast in, all she had. What does he use? He uses our emptiness. So many times we get full. But the Bible teaches us to empty ourselves before God. I don't know this, but all my commentary said that the drought had already been 2.5 years. Can you imagine if America was in a drought for 2.5 years? They say this, and I don't know this, but they say that our resources in America can be eating and taken up in 3 days. I don't know that. But there was a famine in the land. And she didn't have social programs. She didn't have food on her table. She couldn't go get a card and go to the Walmart and get her some food. She couldn't go down to the local church and get anything. I'm not as old as a lot of you are, but I remember the days. Now, other folks in New York City, they didn't have it like we did in Chicago, those places. But I was raised right across the hill over here on a little farm. I had five brothers. And my daddy had a 50-acre farm, and folks, that we dug out a living on that farm. I'm going to go way back to some of you. Y'all don't even know what I'm going to talk about. We lived in a day that we didn't go to the supermarket. The supermarket come to us. Amen? Well, I didn't know anything about Walmart. Didn't know anything about all... Every once in a while, I got to go to the Western Auto. You ever been there? I tell you, folks, I go to the Western Auto, and I wanted one of them Western Flyer. I tell you what, I'd like to have one of them little red wagons. I'd like to have me a bicycle. I'd like to have one with good tires on it. I would even settle for one with a chain on it. No resources. But listen, in our day, it was a time. I remember one time I worked all day long and I got a quarter. You ever done that? On the farm, I got a quarter. And I've told this story before, but you need to hear it again. In that quarter, I picked up Coke bottles in the ditch on Bethlehem. And I took that six-pack of empty Coke bottles or Pepsi bottles, and I took a quarter and I bought me a six-pack of Pepsis. Five stinking brothers. You know what they wanted, Maddie? Pepsi. Pepsi, I want a Pepsi. Mama, make him give me a Pepsi. I worked all day for my Pepsi. You're not getting one of them. And I tell you what I did. I popped the top, took me a drink, spit back in under there, put the lid on it. Backwash them. They won't drink after you. That's the way I made it. You know what? I don't know what I got a black eye, but we had some good fights over them Pepsis. Now, I remember those days. But you know what? I never went hungry. Why? Because God supplied our needs. And I remember this, my forefathers, that we would not only go, folks, to the co-op, or they'd go out somewhere and pick up the seed, but Granddad would save most of the seed, and we'd get a little fertilizer, and we'd get all these, and we called it, we didn't have the granulated, we had the piles. You ever have the piles? You know, that's fertilize. You had to clean out stalls and throw it out there, and you did all that. But you see, God supplied. But this is what would happen in those days. When they got ready to plant their seeds, when they got ready to plant their crops, many of them would get on their knees before God. They'd say, God, we'll starve this winter if we don't have something. God, you send the rain, you send the germination, you send it that we can have something to eat. And folks, I can bear you testimony that I never went hungry. Why? Because God supplied the needs. Now, why didn't God pick out a wealthy widow? Well, they'd be surely a wealthy winner in that city, would they not? Why would God choose a poor little old widow woman that was taking her last cake, having her last meal? I tell you what, I believe this is almost with all my heart. I believe he wanted to glory and show what he can do. Now let's see something else. That was 8, 9, and 10. Now let's see what 11 and 12 says. And I'm going to pick it up and I'm just going to kind of scan it. But the Bible says here that he told her to go fetch him something to drink, and she was willing to do that. But the Bible says that he asked the request. You know what he did? He asked for the last thing she had. There was water around she could get. But he asked for the last piece of cake in the house. A little piece of cornbread, you could probably call it. He said, if this is all you got in your house, I want you to give it to me. And I find this mother's reluctance. You know why? Because of her fear. She didn't see any way that God would take care of her. She couldn't see any way that God could take that little last cake. Why she'd have to give it to somebody. Why her little boy was more precious to her maybe than the man of God. She didn't want it because, you see, there was fear there. The Bible says that she began to talk back to him. She said, listen, I don't have any other resources. Everything I've got's a little cake, and I'm going to make it. And you see, me and my boy's going to die. She focused on how little that she had. Does Satan make you do that? So many times we forget that God's greater when we have less. She had fears. You see, fears rob us of our enthusiasm. It robs us of our confidence. It robs us of our strength. It robs you and I of our expectation. Does God ever ask of something that's unreasonable for you? Has God ever asked anything that seemed out of your reach? Does God ever ask from you to take from your children and give to his work? What do? Do we not take care of our own first? See, she was reluctant because of fear. How many mamas and daddies have been reluctant to follow God and give him all that you've got? Now, I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about your resources, who you are, and your strength, and the things that God has done with you. Folks, sometimes we have decided we're going to do it our way. I'm going to say this to you. This little woman hadn't been obedient to God, her and her boy would have died. So many times, we have come to a point in our lives and across our fiber of our nation that we stand up for the rights of our government, but we won't stand up for the rights of God. Can I say that again? How many of us have come to the point in our moral fiber that we think that the government's right instead of God's right? God had a plan. You know what it was? It was for him to take care of the man of God. God's people, let me say what the old psalmist said. He said, I was once young, now I'm old, never saw the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. I'm not talking about taking care of the preacher. I'm talking about God takes care of his children. No matter how bad it gets, God always takes care of his kids. You know, one of the most paralyzing things that Satan throws at you and I spiritually, that's fear. Fear. But I know what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7. Paul said these words. But God has not given us the spirit of what? You can say it out loud. Say it with me. Spirit of what? But he gave us three things. What are they? Power, love, and what? Do we not need his power today? What's happened to the power of God? It's still around, amen. God's power is still around. And folks, not only that, but the love, in the love of Jesus, still alive. If you're saved and God lives in your heart, the love of Jesus is alive. Whether you accept it or not, God still loves this world. He still loves the lost. He still loves his children. Folks, listen, God does not waver in our attitudes or our actions, but he is a true and a loving God, and God still loves the world. And he still loves his people. I don't care what the world says. He said power and love and what? A sound mind. What happens, folks? Fear comes and it takes the power of God away. We doubt God's power. And folks, whenever a fear comes, it takes away a love from our hearts. Listen, you can't love with fear. The Bible says that love hides a multitude of sin. And then he moves on and he says, power and love and a sound mind. You see, she was paralyzed because of what little she focused on, what little she had. And I'm sure she said at times, why don't God deal with somebody else in this situation? Why don't God use somebody else? I don't have enough for God to use. I like what Paul said. He says that my strength, speaking of God, has made perfect in thy weakness. You see, this mom, she had a meal barrel that was running out. Empty. There it was, just a handful. A little oil, and it was just in the road. She was focusing on how little she had. You know, one little comment can take victory out of your life. It can take peace out of your life. One little comment, one little deed, one little something come your way. Somebody can say something and take every bit of your joy away. One little thing. Have you ever noticed how God can take one little thing and he can put all that joy and peace back? And happiness. You see, most of us focus on the little things. You think about it, little things mostly control. It's not the big things. It's mostly something little. One in a crowd can take away the joy of the whole crowd. Or one in a crowd can bring back joy to the crowd. See, she is focusing. She had fear. Now, let's move on. Let's go to verse 13 and 14. I like 13 and 14, and we're going to close in just a minute. But it talks about that he says, fear not. I want you to mark down the three F's. Are you with me? If you are, say amen. The three F's in this, he says, fear not. And folks, as I done said something about fear, but folks, she was immobilized because of that fear. It had taken every bit of the expectation away. She was defeated through frustration and depression. But listen, I'm grateful that this little lady, this mother, she, when everything else had come apart, when she had no other resources, when nothing else she could turn to, this little lady relied upon her faith. Have you ever heard it said, well, all I can do is pray? Have you ever said that? Some situations, what we say, all I can do is what? Do you realize that's the greatest thing you can do? It's not within your resources. It's not within your strength or who you are. It's within the power of God. We live, move, and have our existence. The Bible says that when everything else had emptied out, she began to rely on her faith. The meal buyer was empty. And Elijah says, fear not. He told her these three things. He said, fear not, and go do as I've said. Take a little case, a little cake first. He said, don't you eat first. That's the second F. First, this is what happens. Most of us give God the leftovers. Can I get amen from this side? Amen. How about it over here? Can I get an amen? We give God the leftovers? Come on now. Can I get amen? Amen. I'm going to pay all my bills. I'm going to pay all these things. And then God, you get what's left. You know, you can get in such a financial debt that you can't afford to give God nothing. You know what you'll start doing? You'll start losing. Sometimes God allows you to lose some things where that God can work in your life. You see, she began to rely on a victorious faith. Elijah says, fear not. Take away that fear. Just look to God. I'm here to tell you, God will take care of you if you'll do this thing first. Give God his portion. Amen. Yes, well now, preacher, you're going to talk on money. I tell you, folks, money's the last thing I preach on most of the time. God don't need your money. Nor does he need mine. He owns it all anyway. Amen. And I've made this statement I want you to listen to. If you gave God all your money in the bank account, how much richer would God be? You ever thought about that? You know what God treasures? He treasures you. He treasures your life. He treasures who you are. God don't have a bank in heaven. It's not called a heavenly bank that you deposit to. And they've got tailors that take it in by the bucket loads and the wheelbarrow loads and the truck loads and the dump truck loads and deposit in God's bank. And he says, my bank's rich. God don't deal in these monetary things. God wants us to be rich in faith. What's he say about it? It is impossible to please him without what? Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6. The Bible says, she was rich. She relied on her faith. When you come down to nothing, what else is there to do? I could give a testimony, and some of you older folks could, some of the older people, and I've heard testimonies many of a time. They didn't know when the next meal was going to come from. But God supplied that need. You know, it's hard to be humble when we got so much. Amen. Can I say that again? It's hard to be humble when we've got so much. You remember when you was at the bottom? You remember when you had nothing? You remember when everything was out of your reach and you was just praying for God to help you? Folks, listen, we were in a humble state in our lives, but when we begin to gather it up and begin to bring the material things together, folks, we get a little security in it and we'll stand on it. We think we've got a job and we've got our health and all these things. But listen, folks, those things can vanish. But the Bible tells us, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven. I remember an old deacon that I met some 40 or 50 years ago, Brother Priorcard, and this was one of his most favorite verses. He had always said, he'd say, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Then he said, all these other things will be added to you. You know what she done? She relied on a victorious faith. She just believed God and what he said. And what happened? The Bible says, he said, fear not. He said, give me the cake first. Then he said, this last F, what is it? Verse 15, bring it on down. He says, the meal barrel shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil what? I want you to know, you stay with God, you'll never fail. He said, listen, I want you to understand this. You may not have everything you want, but you have everything you need. You know what he did? Can I give you the moral of this story? Elijah, the widow, and her boy, her son, lived by the commentaries and my studies, they lived 1 year out of that meal barrel that never did run dry. 1 year they lived. How much does it cost to live a year? Have you thought about that? Now, if it's kind of like my girls, I don't know if you've got girls like my girls or boys like your boys, whatever, they want to eat out at least once a day. Amen? At least once a day. And it's a cost. You know the reason that they have to eat out at least once a day? Because ain't no mom at home cook them supper. Wow. Right? Am I right there? Mom's working, dad's working. All these things happening. You know sometimes how we have an evening meal? My wife works, comes home, and I go out Granny Mac's and get a bowl of beans, and we have a bowl of beans. One of my favorite times, have a bowl of beans. Aren't we working? Aren't we running to and fro? It seems like the most important thing is having time with her children. This old girl had a victorious faith. As we stand together, somebody gets us a song. I want you to think about it. What do you do when life becomes impossible? What do you do when things become impossible? I still believe that God can triumph in trouble. I still believe God is above and beyond everything we can ever imagine. He said to Paul in 2 Timothy 12:9, he says, Paul, my grace is sufficient. My strength is made perfect in thy weakness. Sometimes we have to come to a weak point in our lives that we'll trust in our God. What do you do when everything's, you're trusting God and just don't seem like there's no way out? I like what Paul told the church at Corinth, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13. He said these words. But God is what? Do you believe that? I believe God's faithful. And he said he'll not suffer us to be tempted or tested. You can put that word tested there and tempted. You read James, you'll find it's vice versa. He said tempted above that which you are able to bear, or tested above that which they are able to bear. But God said, I'll tell you what I'll do. When it comes to point you in a corner, this is my interpretation of it. When you get in a corner and there's nothing else you can do, he said, I'm going to make a back door for you. Or I'll let you walk out the front door, either one. Why? Because God is greater than any circumstance that you and I will ever face. You see, we've got to rely on our victorious faith. It's a faith walk, church. We please him by faith. We walk by faith. And we give him glory by faith. Everything in our world, we can't bear it without faith. That's what he says. He said, you'll be able to bear it only through faith. And let's just answer this question this morning. What do we do when our resources run out? Most of us never think about God and his hand until the meal barrel runs empty. As long as it's full, yeah, you know where I'm going. Yeah. But she relied on a victorious faith. She believed what God said. The Bible says he supplied the needs. Church, he's still able to do that today. I don't care what your need, if it's need to be saved, God can save you this morning if the Holy Spirit's dealing with your heart.